The man who's all over this, Associated Press Global News correspondent Rob Harris, good friend of this show. Rob joins us live. Rob, good morning to you. I mean, the Olympics, all right, they're going ahead. That's one thing. But with no spectators, what on earth are we about to experience?
Yeah, good morning. There's a real lack of willingness around Japan for these games to be going ahead at the moment. So the opinion polls showing as much as a third of the population doesn't want them to be staged because of the coronavirus concerns. Think of this, in the next few days, we've got thousands of athletes starting to arrive in even bigger numbers in Japan from all around the world. And they're really concerned about the coronavirus rates there. They are only hovering around 1,000 new cases a day, unlike ours, which obviously in the tens of thousands a day, but they are rising, and that's what's creating these concerns. The one thing that is perhaps hopeful for the games and the atmosphere is we're only talking about the venues directly around Tokyo that are going to have to be without spectators. There is still hope that some of the venues outside of Tokyo could have fans, and that is good news for the Team GB footballers, and they are potentially going to actually have some fans at their games as they prepare to for them. They're actually just headed out the women's team this week for that.
The thing is, Rob, as we've seen, Simon's going to come in a second, as we've seen in the Eurozone, what a difference fans make at a major event. I saw that the other night at England-Denmark, 60,000 inside Wembley. The difference is incredible. The difference is absolutely vitally important. Now, Simon, you're taking this. Am I wrong that the decision to have no spectators at the Olympics is rather like a sledgehammer to crack a nut?
Well, I think it's a tragedy. I mean, it's not for us to tell a country how to conduct its policy towards what it believes are its societal obligations. But when you look at it and you say this is a country that has, I think, 140 million people in, has currently has 14,000 deaths, and I know the argument would suggest that that's what they want to keep it at. But I think there's been a negative approach to having this games for some time. And it's a tragedy when you think about it, because you've got what is unarguably, irrespective of football World Cups and European Championships, the greatest sports show on earth that's been put back a year. In a country that doesn't seem to be accelerating its vaccine program for whatever reason, doesn't seem to be getting jabs in arms like we are in this country, in a country that seems to thrive on organisation, yet the world's greatest sporting event is now bereft of supporters. There's no 100-metre electricity in the stadium when the 100-metre gun goes and the fans are part and parcel of sucking it in. Have you got any insight as to why this has been allowed to manifest itself purely and simply beyond the fact that these people are living in a fear culture rather than one that suggests that people have to live with COVID? Rob?
Well, exactly. As you point out, only around 15% of the Japanese population has been vaccinated, and that's one of the reasons why they're having to try to contain the spread of coronavirus. And it really will affect the atmosphere of the Olympics. It's about a festival of sport. It's about the world coming together to watch perhaps a lot of sports that don't get the attention all year round normally. And it's for athletes who perhaps don't always get that attention as well. They suddenly get these big packed venues. They get a bit of limelight, and it's really going to diminish the occasion. We did see a bit of a forerun of all this in an accidental way when I was at the World Athletics Championships in Doha in 2019, when actually they suffered from low attendances just through local indifference. And it really diminished events like the 100-metre finals when perhaps there was only 1,000 people in the stadiums. And as you're saying, these Euros have shown just what it's like to get that electric atmosphere back, whether it was Wembley the other night, post-match Sweet Caroline booming out, as a packed stadium really energising the players. And what we might also see questions of in Tokyo is, yes, there will be an opening ceremony without fans, and an opening ceremony is all about a country showcasing itself to the world. But there will still probably be some dignitaries that will get there, and they'll probably get a bit of attention, actually, those who are allowed in and those who aren't.
It's interesting, Martin, isn't it? The dignitaries will be there, but the fans won't.
Well, we had the Olympics here in 2012. And what a fantastic occasion it was. We tried to go to as many. It was very difficult to get tickets, by the way, but we all tried to take it in. And some of the events, I love the Olympics, and that you know, Simon touched on it, that 100 metres final when the whole stadium breathes as one.
Yeah, and the competitors are introduced individually.
Just, 9 seconds, 10 seconds of brilliance.
Yeah.
And we're going to be denied that now. And the people of Japan as well are not going to get to go and see it. So it feels really sorry for them that as an event, it will change it massively.
Well, I mean, this is the thing, Rob. Nick Kyrgios, quite typically, has decided, well, it's not for me. Sorry, it's not for me. So he's pulled out the tennis because he doesn't fancy it in an empty stadium. I wonder, even at this late stage, will others follow suit?
Well, one of the great appeals of the Olympics, particularly perhaps for those athletes who are used to bigger events, whether it's in golf or tennis or whatever, is the Olympic Village. All the mixing with different sports and a very different environment. It's going to be nothing like that in the Tokyo Olympic Village, where they're going to maintain social distancing. People are going to have to eat apart, you know, go in your rooms, spend a lot of your time in your room. So it's going to take away from that sort of coming together of the world again. And athletes can't go out and about in Tokyo as well. You can't go into a bar. You can't go to a restaurant. You can't
use public transport. But as a tennis player, over the last year, besides tub thumping against Novak Djokovic, he will have been used to that. He's running around the world, staying in hotels. He just wants to draw attention to himself. Because isn't it the flip side of this argument that the 2021 Olympics, if you participate in it and win a gold at a monumental time when the world's coming out of a pandemic, that has some sort of resonance, even more so in history, that you were at the Olympics that were competed during a pandemic and you came away with a gold. It's all about how you spin the argument, isn't it, Rob?
Yeah.
Yeah, and actually even just helping the games go ahead, particularly if you're a big star, helps athletes from smaller sports, because for this is their big moment. This is their chance also to win medals that help them gain sponsorships and continued funding so they even can just compete in their sport. We've seen UK Sport today talking about their medals targets and, you know, being a bit more cautious because of the pandemic disruption. It's agencies like UK Sport that determine whether athletes get their funding. And so much is about the money. So many say, well, the Olympics is only going ahead so the IOC can keep their broadcast revenue. Well, actually, it's that revenue that gets redistributed into sports so sports can be funded all year round.
Sure. Rob, thank you so much. Rob, you've got your own fans out there. There's Katie, one of a few, saying Rob Harris right across with the information. As always, AP Global News correspondent on the Olympics. Sure, the athletes will be there, the dignitaries will be there, but there won't be any spectators.